Thank you for watching the following service recorded live at our 2013 summer camp, Unifying Glory.
Okay, I'm giving them to you away today. So you do that. I also want you to access the books that are there. And these are perhaps some of the last books that are left. Okay, so Pastor Patty, if I can give you these books. And I want you to look at this book and say prayer evangelism. Okay, because I'll be talking. Oh, Pastor Patty, can I give you this if you're so kind? Let's give her a big hand. I mean, isn't she wonderful? And I want to show you how prayer evangelism as a lifestyle, not as a program, as a lifestyle, changes the spiritual climate over a region, causes the devil to fall down, and now the demons stop bugging us, and they become subject to us. And we can tread upon every manifestation of evil. So what I told you about that city in Argentina, Resistencia, it went from 5,000 believers to 250,000 believers. What I told you about Indonesia, what I told you about Tahiti, what I told you about other nations, is happening not because of the eloquence of the preachers, but it's happening because the climate change. And when the climate change, I mean, whatever survives in that climate has to agree with the climate. And this is what is my fervent prayer. You're already doing it. Just having lunch with Pastor May this morning, today, and learning so much that is going on. I would say a lot is going on. But I would like to give you just a fine point here and there for you to get it. The Lord Jesus reached his lowest point emotionally in Luke chapter 9. He told his disciples, how much longer must I be with you and put up with you? Perverted and unbelieving generation. I'll tell you, he was up to here. That's chapter 9. Chapter 10, it says that he rejoiced greatly in the Holy Spirit and told the Father, Father, finally the things that are up there, the ones that I saw before I came down, are beginning to happen. It's the only time in the Bible that Jesus rejoiced great. I mean, I'm sure he rejoiced, but the only time that is recorded in the Gospels. And from chapter 10 on, never again Jesus had to face a demon. Very, very interesting. Now, you have, and we were talking today, quite a bit of demonic manifestations because of the abuse, because of whatever. How would you like that the demons will just surrender? I mean, it's biblical. And read the book. You will say, now some of you are doing Bible Googles. Are you sure, Pastor Ed, that from chapter 10 to chapter 24, he never dealt with it? I know. I wrote the book. Okay? No, it's so. It's true. You can live in chapter 9, have a lot of fun, casting out demons, doing deliverance, you know, and that's okay. We need that. There are many moments when you have to help people be set free. But if you can change the climate, I'll tell you, the demons cannot live in a righteous climate. And so the Lord Jesus told the 70, I want you to follow a four-step strategy. Number one, okay, let's see if I can get it to work. Number one, bless the people. He said, you are lambs, they are wolf. I mean, lambs don't feel like blessing the wolf. Christians don't feel like blessing perverts. But the Lord says, you bless them. Why? Because blessings break curses. Curses can never break blessings. So he said, first, a change of heart and live it out by blessing those that curse you. Number two, fellowship with them, eat and drink, and let them pay for it. Yep, that's what it says there. I mean, eat and drink what they give you. So play visitor. Now, Pastor Brian was telling me that not too long ago, they were cooking hamburgers on a Friday night, and the owner of a bar or a strip club or something came and paid for all the hamburgers. You see, it's biblical. Let them pay for it eventually. Okay, at first you need to prime the pump. So you see, say bless, fellowship, You are not preaching yet. You're just fellowship. But now you have them close range, right? Number three, minister to them. Whatever needs they have. And this is a gift over this area. This is a gift that Pastor Patty has, that Pastor Maid has. I mean, that many brothers have. I know this brother has it too, you know. You really care for people. You really minister to people. And then and only then open your mouth and preach and proclaim. So he says, bless, repeat after me, bless, fellowship, minister, proclaim. In the old paradigm, we began with proclamation. We say, repent or burn. They shut the door and we curse and say, you will burn in hell. And then we wonder why they don't like us, right? But in the new paradigm, you know, especially for shy people like me, this is music to my ears. I don't have to preach it in the first move. I just bless them, soak them up a little bit, fellowship, enjoy something, watch soccer or something like that. And then you do something good for them. And then at the end, when they feel the power of God, they say, what happened to me? Oh, the kingdom of God has parked next to you. Would you like to get in? And they do. So I'm going to tell a story that is captured in these two DVDs. These DVDs are very helpful because they tell the story. I'm going to show it to you now for you to see how good they are. You can go home. You can bring your people, show them the DVD, and then their faith is going to grow. Pastor Brian was telling us a very compelling story, but when we saw the pictures there, we said, wow, that's good. So I want to tell you this. There was a fellow who planted a church, and the church tanked, went belly up. He has spent all his money there. He was discouraged, and he began to drive a taxi. And he felt like he failed the ministry because he was called to preach, and he's driving the taxi. Until he read my book, Prayer Evangelism, That None Should Perish. And then he realized, I am not a taxi driver, I am a minister. This is not a taxi, this is a mobile Ark of the Covenant, you know. I'm just picking up people and soaking them into the anointing. And he began to bless them and speak peace over them. And people say, I don't know what it is, but when I take your taxi, my day is better. Can you be around? So his clientele increased. This has to be like the ice cream lady. I mean, there is no sustainability if you do kingdom things and you go broke. You have to do kingdom things and make more money for the kingdom. So he did that, and then one day he connected with a brand new believer, and you will run into these kind of people, who has inherited 8 corporations from his father, who was not a believer. This is in the Philippines. The problem was that one of those corporations was a motel chain, 14 motels, about 14 motels, 2,000 employees who were in cahoots with 3,000 prostitutes, and they use every motel room 5 times a day, 4.7 times a day. So here you have 15,000 acts of sexual immorality committed in that motel. In the old paradigm, you sell the motel, give the money to missions, and pray for the rapture to come. In the new paradigm, you say, wait a moment, you know, greater is he who is in me than that idiot who is in the world. I can do all things. So he realized, okay, I am a minister. And so he was discipled by the taxi driver. I mean, this guy hired as his spiritual advisor. And then there were 30 pastors. And this businessman told them, I will pay you a salary to keep your mouth shut. I don't want you to preach. I want you to join the 67 task forces that make up a motel chain, you know, from janitorial to cooking to whatever. And you are not to preach, you are to bless. Then you fellowship. Then you minister. And then and only then, when something happens, you open your mouth. But 3 pastors couldn't overcome their training, so they opened their mouth and they got fired on the spot. I'm not paying you to preach, I'm paying you to bless. But they continued to do that. Now, in a matter of 2 years and 3 months, all 2,000 employees have become Christians. Somebody say hallelujah for that. But as they were becoming Christian, they were taught, you are anointed for business. You are not a maid, you are a minister. So a maid will make a bed unto the glory of God. She will invite the presence of Jesus to welcome the people that will use the room. Now imagine a John with a prostitute showing up and God say, hello guys, how are you doing? That has an instant chilling effect, you know, on the people. Now here you have a cook flipping a hamburger unto the glory of God, a receptionist. And then he went ahead and built prayer chapels in each one of the motels. And then when you check into the motel, they give you the key to your room. They tell you, welcome to our motel. And if you need a miracle, dial 7. Because our intercessors are on duty. And they did that. And in 1 year and 8 months, over 10,000 clients received the Lord. Somebody say hallelujah to that. Now, it didn't stop there. I don't have the time tonight because this is just the appetizer, okay? But out of that, I mean, the commander-in-chief of the army of the Philippines became a Christian. The chief of the police became a Christian. The justice of the Supreme Court became a Christian. One of the wealthiest women in the world became a Christian. And today the Philippines is fast approaching the tipping point when that nation will be totally transformed. But it began in a taxi with a frustrated, failed preacher. So let the Lord speak to you now. Let the Lord tell you, if I can do it in the Philippines, I can do it in Canada. So now we're going to watch this 12-minute DVD, and then I'll come back and I'll give you the main dish.
Ordinary men and women doing extraordinary deeds. Whispers of prayers echoing through City Hall from early dawn to the setting sun. Poverty being eliminated and dignity being restored to impoverished communities. This is the story of Parañaque City, a city dedicated to God. It is the story of one city that has impacted a nation. When God begins the transformational process, he often starts with a small number of people who have a desire to see God change not only individuals, but also cities and even nations. Believers start trusting God for favor with people in positions of authority. And before long, these leaders responded to God's grace. Parañaque then experienced a major breakthrough when the city mayor boldly declared his city a city dedicated to God.
Our city was dedicated to God by our mayor. Many things just suddenly happened. For once, the income of the city has quadrupled. And then the peace and order improved, our problem on garbage collection was solved, and even our peace and order, they have improved significantly because the number of inmates in our jailhouses is only half of its capacity.
The pastors of Parañaque, they come here every morning, 8 o'clock, for the last 6 years. And they've been praying for the city, for me, for the department heads, for all the employees, so that we'll take the right path.
Determined to continue the mission of city transformation, believers gathered late into the night, walking the corridors of City Hall. Trusting God, they boldly declared the Lordship of Christ over this city.
Building for your name's sake, oh God, we thank you, Lord.
It's only God who can really direct us, you know, and bring us to the right path. So we want God to supervise.
Acknowledging the need for great discernment in his position of leadership in government, this mayor created a unique position in his administration, that of spiritual development consultant.
He invited me to come to his office, but at that time, he wanted me to be included in the pool of his workers, and then he looked what will be the appropriate a position that I will be fit in. So he taught about that spiritual development consultant.
As Pastor Fred assumed the responsibilities of spiritual development consultant, the climate of City Hall began to change. The Philippines is known to be one of the most corrupt nations in Asia. So one of the most noticeable effects of transformation was the decline in corruption at City Hall.
Once, we were offered one BMW each and 1,000,000 pesos, but we knew what the consequences would be, so we said no. Every day, we are faced with temptations in the office, but we remain firm to always say no, and that is the main factor that we have been able to reduce the corruption in City Hall.
As transformation started taking root, word soon spread that City Hall was not only the place to pay taxes, but also to receive prayer for financial issues and even physical healing. A true indicator of transformation is the elimination of systemic poverty. And this process is greatly accelerated when the church is able to come alongside government institutions.
We are now in one of the poorest of the poor in the city of Parañaque. And just look around their living conditions, how their quarters look like. And this is where true transformation happens, when the church partners with the government and they help in eliminating systemic poverty by eradicating systemic corruption, and now they're providing free houses to the poorest of the poor.
Then when we learned about transformation of Ed Silvoso, that now changed our paradigm, that it's not enough as a church, as a person, as a pastor, to bring the gospel and bring them to the salvation, but bring an effect of the gospel to their life here on earth as it is in heaven.
Abundant life and transformation for the poor is not just providing single meals. It is the opportunity to be educated and given the hope of a better tomorrow. It means teaching men and women to plant crops and feed their families. Breaking systemic poverty means providing a hope that they will not only learn to fish, but one day also own the pond.
In a few months, they will be harvesting the crops. This is about 40 pesos per bundle.
City transformation is a task that requires great vision and great unity. It requires the church to embrace the entire city and not just their own congregation. And so, every Saturday morning, Parañaque pastors come from all denominations to receive training, so that they may be deployed in the process of city transformation.
I see that there's an important role, an important partnership between people like me, you know, people who aren't pastors, but who are into business, who are into writing, who are into media, and our church leaders. I see that they need help, and I also see that I need help, that a lot more ground can be taken when we fuse together and take the city, take the nation for Jesus.
The business sector is also beginning to experience restoration and renewal.
Today, I'd like to say that I have been elected as a board of director of one of the third largest bank here in the Philippines. What makes me qualified? It says the Lord Jesus Christ. And I ask myself, why am I put in this position? It's because I know God is increasing my area of influence to bring the gospel. And I know someday I'll be able to talk to the president of this corporation, to this bank, and be able to bring the heart of God until the whole banking system will be one for the Lord Jesus Christ.
I believe that labor is worship. That's why we establish the Kingdom of God, where there is a construction project. We always see to it that we pray for our workers, for their safety, that they will not meet any accident or become sick. We even pray for their families whenever there are special prayer requests.
Transformation happens little by little or step by step. It all began when the owner of the hotel opened his company for God to be welcome in the company.
We used to run and operate group of companies wherein we had 14 motels, 1,400 rooms. It was an immoral business because we catered for the privacy. We provided privacy to couples, illicit couples. And At the time, we had 4 turnovers, a total of about 11,000 customers every day. And it was an altar of unrighteousness, because the sin was committed on top of every bed 4 times a day.
As the gatekeeper, it is my role to keep the kingdom of God in here secured. Our room attendants, every time they clean, before they clean the room, they make a prayer. And then after cleaning the room, they do a prayer.
This hotel chain have indeed taken the kingdom of God right into the heart of the marketplace. And staff regularly meet for times of worship and encouragement. Designated places for prayer are open to both the staff and guests. As Parañaque started experiencing the blessing of a city in the process of transformation, it happened. Surrounding cities heard the good news. Politicians saw the result of godly leadership, and Parañaque became a detonator city.
True transformation happens when every sphere of our society is changed and transformed. It touches the heart of the marketplace, the combination of business, education, and government.
We believe that unless God will be in the heart of every police officer, we will never see a genuine change in the police. That's why our battle cry is, God in every cop. And right now, I believe we have more than 90,000 police have undergone this purpose-driven life seminar. That's why in the development of the spiritual dimension of the police, I use normally the purpose-driven police.
So God has impressed upon me, why not launch the same purpose-driven life campaign in the military? So it was then in that time, after much prayer and consultation, that the Lord has impressed upon me to write a letter to then Secretary Avelino Cruz, of the Secretary of the National Defense, offering this purpose-driven life seminar to the generals.
And this instruction to follow God's blueprint has come as a direct command from a man who, despite his military rank, has understood Christ's command for servant leadership.
I believe that always a position to lead the other people is God-given, and it goes
as well. I am a public servant, nothing more, nothing less. Then when somebody sits there, I am not the commander. I should be of service to them. But what I see every day is not public service. What I see every day is what is written here. This will keep reminding me of what I should do in all my transactions, in all my dealings, in all my decisions. I should always, every time I sign something, I'm always reminded that I am a servant of the Lord.
When a gatekeeper welcomes God into his sphere of influence, I believe the climate, the spiritual climate of that place is significantly changed for the better. I mean, it's now more conducive for God to work because he is welcome into that place, into that area.
Believing in the spiritual authority given to gatekeepers, Ed and Ruth Silvoso were eager to release a blessing and to pray with national leaders. Together, they asked the Lord to reveal strategic methods for redemption and restoration.
Bless our congresswoman, our senator, that your love and peace be upon them.
Praying for those in authority is the cornerstone for transformation in the Philippines. And pulpit and marketplace ministers are eager to ensure that from national to local government, their elected leaders are encouraged and supported.
Dear Father, and today, I open my heart to Jesus.
Building God's kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. This is our mandate, and Parañaque City is leading the way.
And why not? You know, the Philippines being discipled by Christians.
Nation transformation includes praying for the sick in their homes and in City Hall. It is about bringing good news to those who are rich and those bound by poverty. It is about taking care of our environment and praying for those in authority. It is about leaving a Christ legacy in your nation. It is about going into all the world and truly making disciples of every nation.
Amen. That was the commander-in-chief of the army. 40 generals were put through training, received the Lord. One of those generals was appointed the chief of police. He put 90,000 police officers through training. Remember what I showed you the first night, the tipping point? Okay. You need the point of inception. And if this region is the point of inception, it will keep going until all of Canada has heard the voice of God. I understand that video and audio tapes of this conference are available. I encourage you, get those, because you would like to review these with your group, with your leader. The path to transformation is the city, the state, and eventually the nation, correct? Yesterday, I spoke with you that the Great Commission begins with a command to go and disciple nations. That's Matthew 28. That's the beginning of the church era. And it ends in Revelation 21 with nations and their prime ministers, their presidents, bringing the honor and the glory of those nations to God. That is going to happen because it is written. And we must believe that when that day comes, the Canadian flag will be on that parade, and the Prime Minister will dedicate Canada to the Lord. And then I explained yesterday that the key was to access the leaves of the tree of life to deal with systemic issues that politicians cannot fix. And this is what you are beginning to do already here in Hamilton, in Brantford, in Mississauga, in other places. You access a concept that is a leaf from the tree of life. And I explained to you yesterday that the tree of life is mentioned in only three books in the Bible. In Genesis, where it's infusing life. In Revelation, where it's responsible for healing the nations, and in the book of Proverbs, chapter 3, the chapter on wisdom, where it says, he who accesses the wisdom of God accesses a tree of life. That's why receive from the Lord now. Receive from the Lord that he will give you new ideas, new discoveries, new inventions, new ways of doing things. Receive it! So that you will be head and not tail. You will be a giver and not a taker, a lender and not a borrower. You will be above and not beneath. Receive it in the name of the Lord. So with that as our context, we move now into the biblical rationale for eliminating poverty. The current global crisis, is it financial or is it economic? Well, what's the difference? Well, it's like if your car runs out of gasoline in a tough neighborhood, it's a financial crisis. You get more gasoline, put it in the tank, and it takes off. But if the guy who drove your car without your permission and ran out of gasoline in a tough neighborhood never told you where he left it, and then the day that you go to reclaim it, you find that the wheels are missing, part of the engine has been chopped away, okay? And then you call the AAA or whatever you call it in Canada to come and tow it and bring some gasoline. And the driver tells you, listen, whoever drove your car also borrowed money against your car. And there is a lien on your car. And you cannot get it until you, your children, your grandchildren sign themselves for indenture. Then what began like a financial crisis deteriorated into an economic crisis because of the stupidity of the people in government. So I believe that the current crisis is an economic crisis, but this is our opportunity. Because when you look in the Bible, Daniel saw this coming. He saw a statue, remember? The head of gold, the shoulders of silver, the torso of bronze, the legs of iron, and the feet, a mixture of iron and clay. And the clay made it vulnerable. And then he also saw a stone not cut by human hands that was thrust against the statue, and it hit it in the clay, and the statue tumbled, and the stone grew into a mountain. Right? I believe that clay is populism. That is what has destroyed Europe. That's what is destroying America. You draw your own conclusions about Canada. The more the state gets into welfare, the more clay that is added. That's the bad news. But the good news is that it has to get worse for the clay to be of such a magnitude that when God will use people to bring it down, that thing will topple, but not to bring chaos to the world, but to bring a new order, okay? Where the trees of the field will clap their hands, and the lion and the lamb will eat together. There will be no tears, no pain, no suffering. That is the future when people take the kingdom of God to where the gates of Hades are. That's why I have encouraged you, and I will not insist, but I will encourage you to come to the global conference in Hawaii. You're going to see these folks, these generals, this president. You will see simple people as well, that they are doing it. Because I believe that we are within a few years of hitting the tipping point in the global economy. In fact, my next book, the title is, it's not Anointed for Business, I already wrote that one. It's called Anointed for Politics. And the byline is how to swim in dirty water without drinking it. You know? And there in that book, I'm explaining how we Christians, and you're already modeling this in a macrocosmos, we must capture the middle of the political arena to become reconcilers and at the same time to lead. So, to understand this, we need to see that capitalism, when it was first developed, it was moral. Because capitalism was developed by the Catholics, by the monks, that they ran a microeconomy in the monasteries after the fall of the Roman Empire, and they began to produce more goods than they could consume. Up to that point, people just produce enough goods for the day, and then tomorrow we'll see what we do. And they had a surplus, and they have to sell it, and because they needed to sell it, and they have enough that bartending was not adequate, the Italians, where the Roman Catholic was based, invented the bank. So that because of that seed, you know, being Catholic, being Christian, it had a high moral content. Capitalism was not designed to help the poor. No, capitalism was designed for the capitalists to make money. But because it was designed by Christians, there was a strong social component there that you must help the poor, you must help the needy, and you must prime the pump of those that are dry. Then the Protestant ethic came and was attached to the Catholic concept, and it took off, and with England and others, it went to the four corners of the earth, and capitalism is the only economic theory that generates wealth. Socialism distributes wealth, communism misappropriates wealth, only capitalism can produce wealth. But later on it became amoral, say amoral. And my theory is that that happened during the presidency of Dwight Eisenhower, because he has been the commander-in-chief of the Allied forces in Europe during World War II. He saw millions of people slaughtered during the war. And during the Cold War that followed World War II, he didn't want to see more people killed. He didn't want to send troops to war. So what did he do? He built up the CIA. And the CIA began to bribe every dictator, every immoral person, that as long as it swore, "I am an anti-communism, you're a friend of us." And when the U.S. government compromised that moral standard, now the corporations began to do the same thing, and they began to bribe people to pass laws that didn't make illegal to do that which was not necessarily immoral, but it was amoral. And then it got worse, and it became immoral, and this is what we see today with the derivatives and the bubble bursting and so forth, to the point that now people are talking of the failure of capitalism. But I submit to you that capitalism has good roots, and God is calling people, even in this auditorium today, and people that will be watching by the video, to reverse the trend so that it can become again moral and not immoral as it is today. So my book, Transformation, I think there are some left, at least one that I turned, is the only book that I know written by an evangelical who is a phenomenological theologian that deals with the issue of macroeconomics and how the kingdom of God will come. So going forward now, nation transformation must be tangible. This is the fifth paradigm, remember? And the premier social indicator must be the elimination of systemic poverty. Now the question is, why poverty? I want you to pay attention to the screen. Because poverty invaded creation right after sin came into existence. What was abundant became scarce. And then God said to Adam, from now on, you will have to earn the fruit of the ground rather than get it for free. And you will have to trade it with the sweat on your brow. And then as a visual reminder that sin created poverty, God says, and you will see something you never saw before. You will see thorns and thistles, which are useless, you know, as whatever they are, weeds, vegetables, whatever you call them. So that's where poverty began. However, when Jesus carried the cross toward Golgotha, he walked on La Via Dolorosa. La Via Dolorosa was main street in Jerusalem, was the marketplace. And he carried a crown of thorns on his brow, so that the first blood will touch the symbol of the poverty that was there. Furthermore, when Jesus spoke and preached for the first time, he said, "I have good news to the poor." Unfortunately, the King James says, "The Spirit of the Lord has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor." And the moment we hear gospel, it goes over our head. And to preach, no, to proclaim, like a representative of the emperor, the creator of the universe, he says, "I have good news for the poor." What is good news for the hungry? Food. What is good news for the naked? Clothing. What is good news for the poor? That they will be delivered from the curse of poverty. Do you realize that this is the very first proclamation that Jesus made? Before he said anything else, he said, "I have good news for the poor." Now you go to Acts 4:34, and this is what I'll prove to you as I progress in my presentation. The early church did not have poor people. Contrary to folkloric beliefs, it says there were no needy one among them. The early church did not have poor people, and that's why Jesus' proclamation was immediately fulfilled. Then you go to Acts chapter 6, there was no hungry people, no widows, ethnic widows that were hungry. You go to Acts 20, and Paul says, "All the people in Asia heard the word of the Lord, and I show you that by working hard in the marketplace, we will have a surplus to help the needy. So that Paul always led with social action. Now you go to Galatians 2:10, and Paul was being questioned. Is he an apostle or not? He was not in the upper room. He wasn't recruited by Jesus. So there was a sense of illegitimacy thrown at Paul all the time. And the guy was making more converts than Peter, John, and James put together. But they say, you are not a member of our denomination, okay? You don't have a union membership. You are not an apostle. I don't know if you noticed, did you ever doubt that Paul was an apostle? No. But when he writes, he is almost sickly insecure. I'm an apostle. I tell you the truth. I lie not by the will of God, but not by the will of men. Why? Because they drove him nuts telling him, you're not an apostle. So now Paul has to go and face the executive council in Jerusalem. And there is a triad there, John, James, and Peter. And boy, that was stuck against Paul, because Peter criticized Paul in the Bible. That's how much he didn't like it. James flunked public relations in college. I mean, he was sandpaper to anyone. And John was kind of a token good guy, you know, because he's one vote, we have two votes in favor. So I imagine Paul the night before going through all his notes and saying, what are you going to ask me, because my apostleship being recognized depends on that. And eventually he faces the tribunal and they say, Paul, we have only one question. And if you answer it right, you are an apostle. If you don't, you are not. And God was the question, would you take care of the needy? And when Paul says, I'm eager to do that, they stamp his passport, you are an apostle. If that criteria were to be applied today, I don't know about Canada, but I can tell you 99.9% of the American apostles will be flunking the test. Do you see how vital that was? That's what validated. Are you willing to care for the needy? Yes, I'm most eager to do so. I'm an apostle. And now you go to Revelation 21, and the nations bring their honor and glory. These are not nations that escaped the great tribulation. These are not nations that were junk off the jaws of the Antichrist. No, these are nations that are wealthy. These are nations that are educated. These are nations that families have been reconstituted. That's how the Bible ends. For the Son of God appeared for this purpose, that he might destroy the works of the devil. So when I was writing the book, because economy is one of my hobbies, I began to read everything on poverty. And the problem that I found is that when people think of poverty, they think of money, or material poverty. And it's hopeless. I mean, look what Obama is trying to do, and the guy cannot succeed. You take away from the rich to give to the poor, and you keep taking until everybody is poor. So it cannot be just material. So I say, Lord, I need a leaf from the tree of life. I need a concept that will illuminate the whole issue of poverty. So the Lord took me to the Lord's Prayer. And there we are instructed to pray, Our Father, give us each day our daily bread. And this is color-coded, so when you review this, the colors will help you remember the points that I'm making. And look, it's color-coded. And out of that came an insight that has opened the doors for me and for the people in my spiritual family into the high corridors of power, because I'm showing them that material poverty is just the symptom. When you look at that prayer, we see that poverty is spiritual, is relational, is motivational, and is material. Would you read it with me now? Okay, let me get there. Say, spiritual, relational, motivational, and material. It's spiritual for those that don't know that God is their Father. It's relational for those that know God, but they pray, my God, give me today my bread for me to enjoy alone. The first word we have to say when praying the Lord's Prayer is a declaration that we are part of a global family, our Father. And so people that don't know that they are part of a grand family, they are relationally poor. Then you have the people that you give them money today and they need money tomorrow, because you give them seed and they eat it because they don't have the motivation. They don't have, you know, the ability to multiply that. And then and only then you have the people that are materially poor. They don't have enough bread. Why is this important? When we were hosting in our conference, the First Lady of Uganda, who is a tremendous intercessor, and her husband last October went into a stadium packed with intercessors, knelt on the ground, asked forgiveness for the sins of every president all the way back to Idi Amin, and invited the Lord into the nation of Uganda. But before that happened, yeah, give the Lord a hand over that. The First Lady of Uganda told us, what breaks my heart is when Africa has a famine and they bring these sacks of food and goods and they drop them on the ground and they burst open and my people, like animals, have to forage and pick it up. Furthermore, when wealthy people go and the poor has to stand in line with an empty hand saying, give me something. Because by standing in line, you are saying, I am poor and I will always be poor. So the Lord gave me an insight that has been tremendously revelational. I mean, the poor are poor materially and motivationally. But the poor are richer than the rich. Than the rich spiritually and relationally. Because the Bible says that the poor are rich in faith. And poor people have more friends than rich people. And now here you see the areas, you know, and the rich who are rich motivationally and materially, they are poorer in that thing. So now you look at that, and the key is that both groups are strong and weak in complementary areas, which means that they must work together to eliminate poverty. Amen. You cannot eliminate poverty by making money and giving it to the poor. You cannot eliminate poverty by being a big giver. We must be reconciled, the people that have and the people that have none, because both have something to give to each other. And this is what I want to show to you from the scriptures. Look at Jesus. He said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He sent me to give good news to the poor. That's the material dimension. He says, freedom to the downtrodden, the depressed. That's motivational. Liberty to the captives, relational. And sight to the blind, spiritually. So you begin to see, that's the beauty of being a phenomenological theologian. You see, you look at the scripture, you forget all the commentaries, and you let the scriptures tell you what they really mean. Not only, you know, Paul is saying, not only the Lord's Prayer is breaking that down, but Jesus introduced it like that. So Jesus is saying, in one sentence, I'm here to announce the favorable year of the Lord. In other words, to tell the people that God wants to do favors to them. And this is very, very important. Poverty will be eliminated at all four levels as a favor from God. No one will be able to take the credit for it. I mean, we will all contribute to the process, but it will be a favor. It will be a leaf from the tree of life that will eliminate that. Now, when we look at these four dimensions of poverty, now we go to the book of Acts. I want you to read it with me at the count of three. One, two, three. And the congregation were out of one heart and one soul, and not one of them claimed that anything belonging to him was his own, but all things were common property to them. And with great power, the apostles were giving witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. For there was not a needy person among them, nor all who were owners of land or houses will sell them and bring the proceeds of their sales. When I read this passage in the old paradigm, I thought that it talks about the rich given to the poor. However, when you analyze the passage, look at the circles, them all. It's not talking about the rich only, it's talking about everybody, the rich and the poor doing something for each other. Now, when we follow the color coding now, look at this, one heart, relational, one soul, motivational, common property, material, Lord Jesus, spiritual. You see now, Jesus opened his ministry talking about the four dimensions of restoration, the Lord's Prayer, which is the foundation for our prayer life, includes that. Then you see the early church practicing that. And now you see that the book of Acts tells us that these four things happen in the early church. Furthermore, you look here, says, and the congregation of those who believe are of one heart, one soul, one thing, blah, blah, blah. But I want you to pay attention to the middle verse. Would you read it with me? And with great power. 1, 2, 3. And with great power. What does that mean? It means that when they testified that Jesus rose from the dead, meaning he's alive, they did it with such a power that abundant grace was needed. Now remember, grace is good for only one thing, sin. So the implication is that many people believe in Jesus, many sinners got saved when the apostles told them Jesus is alive. Now, when you read the scripture, it says that maximum 500 people saw Jesus risen from the dead. Here it's telling you that an unlimited number of people believe that Jesus is alive. Have you heard people who are non-believers say, I don't believe in God because if there was a God, there would be not the misery that we have in the world today. I mean, if there was God, why are people dying of hunger? If there is God, why are people dying of famine? Right? Have you heard that? Okay, so they need to know that God exists. Now look at the next verse. It said there was not a needy person among them. Now listen carefully now, because this is the key to transformation. This verse means that the witness of the resurrection of Christ became credible because of the visible transformation happening in the social arena. People said it has to be God and it has to be Jesus because there is no way that you can eliminate poverty. Do you see now why poverty was a central issue in Jesus' mission? Why poverty was a central issue in the book of Acts? And why what the devil intended for evil in Hamilton and this region is nothing more than a bag of lemons for Christians to turn it into lemonade? How we can take that where sin has abound, we can bring grace? And I'll tell you, when we can present a new social order that is not based on having or not having, but is based in being fulfilled, now we will win the world. However, there are two enslaving misperceptions, and you can read the full version of this in my book. Number one, nations that are poor have no wealth. Have you heard that before? It's not true. There are no poor nations. Brazil is wealthier than America, but is poorer than America because these nations have a system of poverty. The wealth is there, but the Babylonian system has co-opted the wealth, and the way the wealth is handled, okay, causes poverty. A nation that is poor, if you define poor as not having enough to survive, is gone in one generation. Every nation on the face of the earth has wealth, But every nation on the face of the earth has a system of poverty. Those are the gates of Hades, but we have the keys to those gates. The second misperception is that poor people are the problem. There are so many of them. I mean, it's overwhelming. How can we handle all the poor people? Now, let the Lord speak to you now, because according to Ephesians 4:28, the poor are not the problem. The poor, look at the screen, are the raw material for the solution. What do I mean by that? Well, Paul says, he who steals, steal no more. Look, minus 10, he's stealing. Steal no more. Now we made it neutral. That's what police does. They catch a thief, he no longer steals. But now, when that person receives the gospel, not only no longer steals, but now has a desire to work. But work with your hands to have and to be able to give to others. Look at the screen. Faith comes by? Or seeing what? The Word of God. It begins with minus 10 and it goes all the way to top 40. So that, I'll tell you, the greatest greenhouse for transformation are the prisons. Because those are the people that are at the very bottom of that. In America, there are 2,076,530 people in jail every day, last time I checked. That's a city bigger than your city. But by the grace of God, transformation is taking hold in prisons. You saw on the DVD there, 60% of the cells are empty in Parañaque. You will see DVDs from Argentina and Ciudad Juarez, where jails are becoming a laboratory. But anyway, we need to remove those two misbeliefs and then understand that in the New Testament, there is a proven model for the elimination of systemic poverty. Look at Acts 2:45. Would you read it with me? 1, 2, 3. And they began. Now, when I used to read that verse before, I imagined that Brother James, who was a senior pastor, told everybody, next meeting, don't bring any unbelievers, because charity must begin by the household of God, and Brother so-and-so, who has a lot of dough, will be dishing out some of that. But actually, when you examine the verse, it says, and day by day, continuing with one mind in the temple, and breaking bread from house to house, they were taking their meals together with gladness and sincerity of heart, praising God and having favor with. And now you connect the all up there with the all down here, and you tell me if the church was not distributing whatever they had to the entire population. And I can assert that to be the case because verse 46 are daily public activities open to anyone. It was absolutely impolite in Israel, if you are having a meal, not to welcome whoever came to the door, even if he was a stranger. And he says that every day in the temple, that was the public square, and house to house, they were breaking bread, okay? Taking their meals together and praising God and having favor with all the people. When the Bible says, and the congregation was of one heart and one mind, and they have things in common, in my book I explain why I believe that the membership of the church in Jerusalem was no less than a quarter of a million people. They were not a small congregation. They were a large congregation, could be as much as 40% of the entire population. This is the city that crucified Jesus. Why will they come to the Lord? Because the children of God became manifested there. So it says that they were sharing with all, And I submit to you that was with all the people, and as a result, the Lord added to their numbers day by day. I'm an evangelist. I love to see people added to the church. So I asked the Lord, Lord, how can you add daily? He said, very simple, Ed. The church operated not on Sundays. It operated Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. And number two, people didn't have to come to a building. The church, the ecclesia, was in the marketplace. Now, I'm not saying we don't need buildings. I'm not saying we don't need... No, I'm all for it. But that is to prime the pump. You see, in your car, you have an engine and you have a motor. The motor is the one that starts the engine, but the motor cannot move the car. Our meetings on Sundays are the motor, are the ignition, okay? So when I look at that, the Lord says, Ed, it's very simple. The church operated every day in the marketplace. Do you realize that Jesus says, folks, every meal that you have, if two or three of you get together, you text me and I'll show up. Now, do you realize how every lunch break, you know, every gathering of two or three Christians now, in the name of the Lord, you have the presence of God there. Now, when he says that he added daily, it doesn't tell us how many, but it says those. Say those. Those is a plural. What is the lowest plural number you can imagine? Two. Which means that any congregation should grow by a minimum of 730 people a year. That's minimum, entry level. So say, okay, Lord, I'm convinced, okay, I need to grow. How do I do it? You have to get favor with the people. And then I say, how do I get favor? Ed, read. You do favors to the people. That's why the church in Bradford is doing favors to the people. The church in Hamilton is doing favors to the people. But I'm like a doctor confirming your pregnancy. You are not crazy. And if you are crazy, you are not alone. Okay? We need to make this the lifestyle of the church. A church should pastor the city. The church should take responsibility for the city. And now look at this. There is a vertical dimension. They were praising God, something that we do quite well. But there was a horizontal dimension that we are not doing that well, which is having favor with the people. And when you get the vertical and the horizontal, look what happens. The Lord adds daily to their numbers. And I know, and the Lord has shown me this, that very soon, in one day, 28 million people are going to come into the kingdom suddenly, just like that. And when that happens, many people will be perplexed. And it already happened, folks. It happened in Acts chapter 18. Who said that many people were being saved, and the Lord had to come in a vision by night and tell Paul, keep doing it, this is the right thing, I'm with you here, and there is more people to come. Why will God have to come and tell an apostle, it's okay that you have so many people believing and being baptized, and it was non-stop? Why? Because it happened outside of the synagogue. Paul had left the synagogue and he was in the main square, and people were getting saved, and because they were baptized immediately, okay, Paul says, is this right? And when Paul says, I only remember baptizing two households, the house of Achaia and the house of Crispus. And we say, oh, Paul only baptized two people. No, read the text. Two households. A household had an average of 287 people. So after Paul baptized over 500 people, he said, Christ did not send me to baptize, but to proclaim the gospel. And he passed it on to someone else. And folks, this will come. What we saw today in Branford is a cloud the size of a man's fist. That will happen. People will get saved and they will be baptized on the spot. There will be so many people baptized that you will have to deputize the ones that got saved today to preside over the baptism tomorrow, or else you will feel like a hard-boiled egg for hanging so long in water. It's coming, folks. It's coming. You say, well, Brother Ed, you are dreaming again. You are a Latino. You are emotional. Let me tell you, it happened twice, and we missed it. The greatest communicator in modern times is Hollywood or Bollywood or whoever you is your thing. A son of Hollywood by the name of Mel Gibson produced a movie about Christ with subtitles because he did it in the original language. And on February 24, 2004, it premiered all over the world. I don't know what you did in Canada, but in America, we bought all the tickets. We gave them to the members. They gave it to their neighbors. They went to a movie theater. They saw the movie. People were in tears. They were blown away because it was absolutely biblical. But when the lights came on, we said, well, thank you for coming. And if you would like to hear more, come Sunday morning to my church. And very few people come. We should have had the baptistry there. We should have told them, he's alive. He touched you. He will deliver you. You need a miracle. Come, do what we saw in Branford today and dunk them for Jesus. And then we will not have enough buildings where to house them. And we will have to listen to the Lord say, you are doing the right thing. Keep on going. I'm with you here. And I have many more people to come. Because the movie has such an anti-Jew propaganda, you know, that came in the media, it became a hit in Saudi Arabia. I mean, if it's anti-Jew, I want to watch it. So who knows how many millions of Muslims saw the movie because the media said it's anti-Jew. It happened before, but we were not ready for it. And it happened 5 months later when President Reagan died. And his funeral was a proclamation of the gospel one day after the other. And the climatic moment came when the sun was setting on the Pacific Ocean. And his son Michael, with Margaret Thatcher there, with former Prime Minister of Canada there, with Prince Charles there, told the story how President Reagan led him to the Lord and preached the gospel to billions of people worldwide. Oh, folks, let the Lord speak to you. You have the cloud. Now believe God for the rain that is coming. And now, moving this, how did Paul become an asset to so many people? He said, I never coveted anybody's silver. You know that these hands minister to my own needs. I was a tent maker. In everything I show you that by working hard, you must help the weak. And remember the words of our Lord that said, it's more blessed to give than to receive. Look at this. Because Paul did that, it says, all who live in Asia, say all, heard the word of the Lord, both Jews and Gentiles. Because Paul took care of every needy person in Ephesus. And from there he went to Asia. So when I say to you that this region could well be the point of inception for poverty to be eliminated, I'm showing you scriptures that tell us that that happened before. You see, he worked hard to help the needy so that he will be seen like Jesus and he will be a giver, not a taker. But I close with this. It says, and all who live in Asia heard the word of the Lord. But look at this, read with me verse 11. 1, 2, 3. And God, So that the reason why so quickly so many people all over the Roman province of Asia heard the word of the Lord was because not just miracles, extraordinary miracles. And this is the anointing that God wants to give tonight. But I need to caution you, if you receive the anointing, you can only use it for nation transformation. If you use it to build your company, it will jackknife you and kill you. If you use it to build your church, it will grow, it will make you weary and tired. You will become an apostle so you can dump it on someone else and keep traveling or something like that. I'm just joking about that. The anointing for extraordinary miracles, yes, begins in a church, begins in a company, begins in a ministry, but it's not for just the church. It's not just for the ministry. It's not just that for the company. It's for the domino chain effect. And let me show you this. Miracles are extraordinary occurrences. When the Bible says that something that is extraordinary, it must be very extraordinary. So why were they extraordinary? Because handkerchief or aprons were carried from his body to the sick. And the diseases left them, and the evil spirits went out. What I want to highlight before we pray, and I'm going to pray generally, I'm going to give an invitation, because I want you to know that this anointing can empower you, but if you use it for personal benefit only, it will destroy you. What is the context? Why was Paul wearing an apron? And why did he need a handkerchief? Because Paul had a company, a business, a tent-making business. Because people didn't have a change of clothes. Clothes were very expensive. So the way a tent maker worked, he stripped himself naked, except for his shorts, put an apron on top. There was no air conditioning, and they worked hard, and they perspired, and the perspiration soaked the apron. And he used a handkerchief to wipe his brow, and that perspiration went into the handkerchief as well. And then people will take that handkerchief or that apron and take it, and the context tells us they took those all over Asia, which allows us to speculate that probably Paul got a brand new apron and a brand new handkerchief every day. Because people said, I need the one the night before. Because we overreacted to the Catholic teaching, which is not biblical in most cases, about relics. You know, this was touched by a saint, and it has some power, you know. But the truth is that there is evidence in the Bible that when somebody in whose body the Holy Spirit dwells, virtue comes out of that person. Even after death, you have Elijah who has been buried. They stumble, they drop a dead body, boom, and the guy is stood up. So because when our body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, and we are living in the fullness of the Holy Spirit, crucifying the flesh and bearing the fruit of the Spirit, even our perspiration becomes a vehicle for blessing. Now, if you have trouble believing that, let me show you that you already believe that, but you don't believe that God can do it. If you have a witch doctor living next to you, and that witch doctor scatters ashes at the entrance of your house, chances are you will catch a headache and you will say, he's doing witchcraft and I'm feeling the impact. If the devil can do it and he has no power, why can the one who is in you be greater than the one who is in the world? In Argentina, we have a pastor that has an incredible ministry of faith and praying. Praying for the sick. They have had 28 resurrections in his church. It's fantastic what is going on there. And he doesn't just pray a sissy prayer. I mean, when he prays, he sweats it out, you know. And so after he had one of those healing services, they took his shirt to the dry cleaner. And the dry cleaning manager of that store was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. But the moment she touched the shirt, she was healed. Well, for the next few weeks, there was a long line at the dry cleaners waiting for the pastor's shirt. Until they got the message, you don't have to wait until Monday. You can come to it. Now, today, we don't wear aprons. We don't wear handkerchief, maybe. But we wear this. Every text message that you write, every email that you send, everything that comes out of you should be anointed by the power of God. People should receive it and give it. There is a car dealership in Minneapolis where the owner understood this, and the people buy cars, and it's growing by leaps and bounds because they have less accidents, and the insurance companies are lowering the cost of the insurance, because if you bought it in that lead dealership, we have records that you will have. Why? Because this guy lays hands on the car when he sells them. What does it mean to lay hands on the sick and they shall get well? It's not just a bubbling that we say. It's virtue coming out of you and me. So let the Lord speak to you now. I mean, I learned the first day I came that Hamilton is known because of mental illness and depression and all that. But what will happen if this anointing begins to operate? If whatever you do in Hamilton or in Brantford, I mean, what will happen if like the ice cream lady, she lay hands on the ice cream cartons, and the ice cream, when people lick it, something touched them. I'm showing you from the scripture, folks, that this is what happened there. Paul didn't have to go all over Asia. Paul went all over Asia through the anointing that was in him. I was dealing with a very difficult problem in the hotel where we have our conference in Hawaii. And there was a clause in our contract that, you know how it is, somebody sells you the contract, and then that person, you no longer see it. And now comes revenue manager, and they try to reinterpret that. And that clause was going to cost us $265,000. And I knew it was wrong. That's not what I discussed with the person who sold us the contract. But they were hiding this person because a deadline was approaching. I said, Lord, what do I do? And that's when I came across this principle. So I wrote an email to this person that hasn't replied to my emails. And after I had the email on the screen, I laid hands on the screen, and I say, Lord, would you fill me with the Holy Spirit? Would virtue come out of me? And would you attach it to the email so that when I press send, you know, it will go and touch this person? I have been pursuing her for weeks with no success. I send it. Within minutes, she called me. When she called me, I said, you know about the clause? Yes, I do. And they are really pressuring you. Yes, they are. Your job is on the line. Yes, it is on the line. And then I said to her, she was not a believer at the moment, I'll tell you what, because of your job, I don't want you to lose it. I will lose that money because I want you to know that I am a follower of Jesus Christ. She says, Pastor, don't do that. I said, well, is either that or your job? She says, well, is there any other way? And then the Lord told me, ask her for 3 more days to see if you can meet the level that they are demanding that was not in the original contract. So I said, I'll tell you what, can you give me 3 days? And I'll trust God for a miracle. And in 3 days, we got an incredible increase in registrations. not only she was healed because she was sick when I called, she became a believer, and the presence and the glory of God show up at our conference. Why? Because I don't have an apron. I cannot send a handkerchief, but I can send an anointed email. So in conclusion, the entire creation, the entire population of Ontario is eagerly awaiting the manifestation of the children of God. All who live in Asia, you know, they heard the voice because of those miracles. And in closing, I want to tell you this. If there is an emerging corridor in Hindus, Buddhists, and Muslim nations in Asia, why can we imagine a new day for Canada? Why can we not imagine that Canada will arise? Why can we imagine that a nation with the gift of mercy will receive the anointing to heal the sick, to heal banking, to heal politics? But the key then is to receive the anointing for extraordinary miracles. Let the Lord speak to you now as we come to this moment of impartation. Faith comes by and hearing the word of God. So does this make sense? Am I showing you from the scriptures that it happened? And I'm telling you that it happened in recent times with Hollywood, with funerals, and so forth. So if you would like to dedicate the rest of your life to the Lord and the totality of your resources to the Lord, and you will no longer have a kingdom company but a kingdom lifestyle, and you will no longer be a kingdom pastor but you will have a kingdom church, if you're willing to do that and you would like to receive the anointing, I invite you to get up and come forward. And I'm going to invite Pastor Maid to join me here because I'm her guest, and to operate under her covering for this. Would you come forward? There is more room here, folks. There is more room. More room. Would you come up here, Pastor? Yeah. Come. Come, folks. I want you to know that you are volunteering to be a bond servant or a maid servant of Jesus Christ. There is no going back, folks. There is no going back. The Lord will possess you. The Lord will own you. Are you ready? And I can tell you this, the Spirit of the Lord, by His great mercies upon me, He has anointed me to pray for you today, for you to receive the anointing for extraordinary miracles. You will receive it by faith tonight, but you have to use it by faith. You have to move in that. Are you ready for that? So I want you first to raise your right hand before God, and I'm going to lead you in a prayer of submission. And you're going to give God everything you are and everything you have. And when you give it to God, don't complain if He breaks it, because He has to break it before He can multiply it. Okay, that happened with the loaves and the fishes. You will find things different tomorrow. Don't panic. Say, okay, Lord, what are you doing? So say after me. Repeat, Father God, in your presence, in the presence of your angels, I surrender all. Everything, my mind, my body, my family, my church, my business, everything, I surrender all. Let it be known. Let your angels record in the book of memories that today, here, now, at 9:15 on this day of August, I have surrendered all. I am no longer my own. My company is not my company. My church is not my church. My ministry is not my ministry. Everything is yours. You are the Lord. You are the master. I'm your servant. Thank you, Lord, that you receive my offering. And I'll raise both hands. And Father, I pray in the name of the Lord Jesus. I pray, Lord, that now you open the heavens and you pour down the anointing for extraordinary miracles upon everybody here. Now, Lord, put it now, 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 the anointing for extraordinary miracles, oh Lord. Father, I pull down every stronghold. I pull down every preconceived ideas. I set them free, Lord. In the name of Jesus, the anointing is imparted. And say, I have received it. And now I want you to put your hands on your chest. And I want you to look at me and say, I have received it. I want you to tell the one next to you, you have received it. By faith, you have received it. And now I need to tell you this. When we receive things by faith, those things is like a pregnancy. God sent an angel to the Virgin Mary. If you think changing Brantford is a challenge, or Ontario, what if you are a teenage girl and God says, I want to have a son with you? And Mary says, how can that be? Because I'm a virgin. And the angel says, God wants to borrow your womb. And if you say yes, the Holy Spirit will come upon you and he will do the job. That's what you have done today. But go to the passage and see that the next day she got up and went to visit Elizabeth. Because the angel said, in an age of no iPhones, no text messages, no telephones, your relative is pregnant and no one knows that. She went there, and when she walked in, she already had the seed. The seed came out of her and fill John the Baptist with the Holy Spirit. All of you have to find your Elizabeth. All of you have to go someplace in the next 24 hours. All of you have to go and do something for the Lord. What is up to you? But don't sit down and say, I got the anointing. No. Now I'm going to pray, Lord, illuminate everybody. Give them the equivalent of Elizabeth, Lord. Give them now a place where they need to go, a person they need to see, an act, a prophetic act they need to perform. Could be as simple as opening the door. Now, Lord, give it to them so that when they go there, virtue will come out of them and they will know that they have the anointing. Say, I receive it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, go to your seat now. I have one last indication, and then I'm sure Pastor is going to dismiss us. But I want you to listen carefully, folks. You receive the anointing by faith, and you have to use it and earn it by works now. Amen. I don't know when I'll be back, if I'm back, but if and when I'm back, I know that your testimonies are going to be here, and extraordinary miracles will have happened. Amen? Let's give the Lord a big hand, Pastor or Patty.
Thank you again for watching our services of Summer Camp 2013, Unifying Glory. For more information, call us at 905-308-9991 or check our website at www.eagleworldwide.com. Check our product store for great products. Have a wonderful day. God bless.
What a wonderful season that we're in, a season of tremendous blessing. And these waves are coming and coming and coming, and I believe that's part of the whole purifying process and bringing forth that prophetic generation. And how many of you have been enjoying the week of the school, the prophets? I want to tell you, it's good to have the prophets in the house. Something wonderful, something special happens when that corporate anointing for the prophetic is in the house and people begin to gather together. Some great things happen. You know, the testimony with Sister Charlene, almost everybody in the ministry, in every church, in every auxiliary ministry, were all birthed in revelation knowledge and confirmed in the prophetic. Somebody say amen. Being led by the Spirit. A lot of wonderful things, and everything that's happened here on this campground is absolutely miraculous from the way God showed it to us. And, you know, there's a huge vision. We come in to see it here now, and, you know, you see everything seems like it's in place. It wasn't quite that way even just 2 months ago. But some people really have gone out of their way to make this place what it is for each one of us, to be able to host us like this. And the folks that are doing that are certainly that are in charge of that are Reed and Victoria Grassick and the staff and the team they have here. Hey, and if you're part of the interns, can the interns stand up? Where you at, interns? We got some. There's some over here and some over there. Woo! Glory to God. They're doing a great job. Wonderful. It's so beautiful to see what you're doing and to see the fruit of your labor. I want you to know we really appreciate you. You know, this is a big vision. This thing's only just begun. Some of you may not realize or know what's happening right now, but we're in the process now with the city of getting going in for approval to further develop the property here. One of the things that we're going to do, and we've been in for some preliminary meetings, we're going to put a big air structure here. Just on the other side of this tree line, it'll probably be somewhere around 150 feet wide by 250 feet deep. It's going to be big. It's going to be really big. Big enough to have like a soccer field inside. I mean, that kind of big, eh? And youth teams and athletic teams will come in and practice there. It's going to be a center for performing arts. Our school of ministry will probably be moved up there. Just a whole lot of things are going to happen there. And our summer camp services will be over there. We'll be able to host up to maybe 1,500 or more people will be able to be seated in there with a platform. Just beautiful. How many of you know that the tent is a real concept in God? How many of you enjoy coming to a tent? Well, the dome is a 21st century tent. Amen? Yeah, come on now. Heat, air conditioning, artificial surface. It's going to be absolutely beautiful. And there's a lot of other things we're going to do. We're going to put a swimming pool in. We're going to put volleyball, basketball, some paddle boats on the lake. Just a whole a playground for the children. There's a lot of things that are here. And last year, we started the process of raising some funds, preliminary funds, to go in for engineering and things like that. But just this past week, in fact, just in the last few days, one of the families who have been real, how many of you enjoyed the testimonies the other night by Michael and Michael and Herschel Snyman? Wasn't they beautiful testimonies, wonderful, about their family, about their life? You know, their family have been dramatically impacted here at the campground by the camp staff and by the Lord on these grounds. I'm telling you, something special happens when your feet touch ground here. Something wonderful happens. This has been dedicated to the Lord, and good things happen. Every year we have many testimonies. But theirs is really something very powerful and very unique to them. And it's a real family type thing. And their family has gotten together and prayed and feel led of the Lord to give us a camp challenge, a dome challenge. This is for the dome itself that's gone up. You can see it over here. There'll be a little building in the front. But for the dome itself, and they're going to give us a dollar-for-dollar matching funds challenge of $36,000. Hallelujah. So every dollar that we raise from within what we're doing here at the camp, they're going to match dollar-for-dollar up to $36,000. Somebody say amen. Isn't that wonderful? Praise the Lord. And they talked about it in $18,000. Yeah, feel free. Now you know where it is. Everybody got directions to it. Hallelujah. You know, in the Hebrew and in the Jewish traditions and cultures, 18 is a great blessing number. And a lot of times they give in intervals of 18. And this is, how many of you believing for a little double blessing? And so we're believing for a double blessing. So it's going to be a great summer, and we feel that this is a launching time for us, and we feel that there's a huge transference of wealth that's coming. All kinds of wonderful things are happening right now in the midst of all the shaking around the world. Isn't it just like the Lord to bless his people?